By 68, I was becoming somewhat of a famous counterculture underground hero of comics, along with guys like Gilbert Shelton and Wilson. I just cheat him like a wolf did. I never cheat so hard like I should. Funny that some of those guys, Wilson, Moscoso, and Robert Williams, even kind of saw themselves somewhat in the same sphere as rock stars. They kind of tried to play that role, but really real flamboyant and almost kind of macho about being underground heroes. But I kind of always felt kind of funny about that. I didn't know quite how to act as a cult hero. And the music, of course, was a very important part of the hippie scene. That whole part of it left me totally cold. I could not get with that music at all. It did nothing for me. I'd go off in a corner and go to sleep at those things, or just wander out in the street feeling kind of lost and confused about it all. I got involved with a bunch of friends of mine who were into old-time music, and we kind of formed a band and started playing music around different places. My friend Robert Armstrong, who's also a cartoonist in his own right, we formed this band called the Cheap Suit Serenaders. The music business, I found out very quickly, was even more horrible than the comic business as a business. Dealing with all of that stuff was playing in bars and performing in front of crowds was really nerve-wracking. I never really enjoyed having to get up in front of an audience, and I wasn't really cut out to be a performer, so eventually I had to quit doing that. But suddenly, when I was 25, after spending most of my life generally being ignored by most people in the world and being sort of a non-entity, suddenly all these people wanted to talk to me. They just thought I was like this interesting person. You know, I was hot. I was the man of the hour. And I think what it did to the content of my work is it kind of made me more cynical, and the comics got weirder and kind of nastier. I started putting more and more of the darker side of myself in my comics just to say, okay, you know, they love me so much, let's see if they can handle this. That's when I did those big-ass comics and the snatch comics, all that offensive, grotesque sex stuff. Of course, a natural outgrowth of the fame was that the big-time hustlers moved in. Suddenly, I seemed to have lawyers talking for me and guys arguing about percentages and contracts. And I mean, it was all made me rather dizzy, but you know, I thought, gee, I must be really cool. They think I'm such a hot property. That was my trouble. I ate it up. I believed them. They were all my friends. They were going to help me. They loved me. I don't know. How did I know they were going to eat me up and spit me out?
A new world of experience awaits us, my loves. This bathtub is now transformed into a space capsule of truth
wow,
and love.
This is wild.
Yes, yes. Only in naked closeness like this can we all come to know each other.
Yes, right. Very good, Winston, darling.
That's how the Fritz the Cat movie happened. It was one of these high-powered deals. Fritz was this character that I'd drawn a lot of comics about since I was a kid. We had this pet cat named Fritz, and I used to draw comics about him to entertain my little brother and sister. And the first comic strip I ever had published actually was a Fritz the Cat strip that I'd done in 1964 when I was still working at the greeting card company. I sent a two-page strip to Help magazine, and I got this letter in the mail. It says, Dear R. Crumb, We think the little pussycat drawings you sent us were just great. Question is, how do we print them without going to jail? Character gradually evolved into this kind of like rambunctious college student type, and then there was a book published. So these New York, basically TV cartoon media guys saw it and thought it would be a good animated feature.
Fulfillment is important, don't you think so?
Oh, yes, very important.
Yeah. Oh, wow, yeah, now I'm getting to the truth, I think, yes.
Oh, yes.
So it's getting all very clear now.
Oh.
Okay, Weston, here come the truth.
Wow.
Oh, shit. Maybe we better go, huh?
No, not at all. No, look here. You get down over here, and you down, that's right, down like that. That's right, right under here. Oh, watch the foot. No, right, that's right, right under here. Okay. Ready, everyone. Here we go.
I never liked the finished product. The Fritz the Cat movie, I think I thought it was, I don't know, the values or the vision that it had was, somewhat depressing to me. So then I did a comic strip in which I had Fritz the Cat get killed by an irate female ostrich who stabs him in the head with an ice pick. So then they went ahead and did a movie called The Nine Lives of Fritz the Cat. You can't win.